Hey guys, Miss Jager here, and welcome back to World of Tanks.
Woo!
And welcome to the Panzerkampfwagen Ausführung 6 Tiger review. She is going to be the first of the three reviews of the other three German heavy vehicles that I promised you guys a while back. So here we are with the first one. And this one, I'm not going to lie, I'm quite excited for, actually, because this is, of course, the famous Tiger tank. Pretty much everyone who knows anything about World War II history would probably know this tank. Even, I reckon, to a degree, children, when they just when asked to draw what a tank looks like, they're probably going to go with something similar to what this tank is. So, it's just, you know, I'm just going to assume you know what the Tiger is. Otherwise, I'd be impressed. But yeah, there are also elements of this vehicle that are super famous. She was, of course, responsible for a lot of damage to the Allied forces, not to mention famous for the Battle of the Bocage, led by Michael Wittmann, who completely annihilated an Allied column of armored vehicles inside the town of Bocage. And, of course, she was a very dangerous opponent to face on the front lines at Kursk, which, you know, admittedly, although she was eventually outmaneuvered and outgunned, she did take a lot of the Russians with her. So, in this game, she's not as, well, easily overpowered as she perhaps was in the early stages of the war, but she still has a definite fighting power that is to be reckoned with, and when used correctly, will do a crap ton of damage to the enemy and potentially turn the tide of battle, giving you or your team the opportunity to really dig it into the enemy and have an amazing game at the same time. So, without further ado, let's get started. So, the Tiger I Heavy Tank. She is a German Tier 7 Heavy Tank, and you can get to her in three forms, though two admittedly go into one, but still. So, the first way you can get to her is the way of the heavier tanks, which is go through the Panzer IIIe, DW2, VK3001H, then the VK3601H. Or, you can go along the Panzer 38 line, hit the Panzer IV, grab the VK3601H, and then do it that way. Or, you can go through this version and get the Tiger P, which then allows you to get to the Tiger 1 and 30. So, you get a fairly decent level of options to getting to this vehicle if you, you know, want to get this vehicle entirely. And you can potentially skip the nightmare that is the DW2 and potentially the VK3001H. I've yet to play it, so I don't know how bad or good it is. And admittedly, though, I'm going to give you a little bit of a history, though, because, well, I mentioned at the beginning of this video that this particular tank doesn't enjoy the same level of overwhelming fear factor power that she might have had when she first went into field of battle back in 1942. The thing is, though, she wasn't really that great when she came in on the game standard anyway. Like, way back when I first got this vehicle, this particular tank didn't have the 1500 hit points or the good rate of fire that the L71 has now. I think we had less than 1400 hit points with the Tiger tank, and I believe, or it might be that she had 1400 or she was around the 1400. It's been so long since I last had a look at that, I can't quite remember, but she definitely didn't have as much hit points as she did now, meaning that she really couldn't brawl in an engagement, and her rate of fire with the L71 doubled that importance, because, like, you had to have a medium caliber gun rammer. It used to be a medium and then they changed it to a large, but no, you needed a medium caliber gun rammer to actually have any hope of doing relatively okay. And then when patch 8.0 came, 8.0, or in the 8.0's patches, Wargaming realized this, and they decided to buff the Tiger tank by adding a whole bunch of nice things. Primarily, it was the extra hit points, giving it up to 1,500, and a nice increase to the rate of fire of the tank. So, speaking on that, let's have a look at the stats. So, you can see 1,500. This is the same level of hit points as an IS-3. So, that's not a bad thing. That is definitely something to be happy about, because it means that you, while can't really take a, you know, you, obviously because of the situation you're in, most of the guns will be able to do high levels of damage to you, but at least you'll be able to tank a couple of shots if, for example, a Ferdinand comes around the corner with a big ass gun, or God forbid an ISU with a BL-10 comes along. So there are very few vehicles that can one-shot you from the top. I think artillery, and maybe if you're very unlucky, Amorax and high alpha rolls will put you in a very bad spot or dead completely. So That is something to be happy about. Though don't forget, that means you have a big buffer. Doesn't mean you have a lot of reasons to go out into the middle of nowhere and die needlessly, because that will not save you. It just won't. Going on to weight, you weigh 58.3 tons with 3 equipment modules attached, and you have a maximum tonnage of 61. This, in combination with your 700 horsepower, gives you a top speed of 40 kilometers per hour. The specific horsepower per ton is 12, which is not bad, it's not great, but for a heavy tank weighing 58 tons, that's pretty cool. Like, that works. Like, you know, tier 8 engine. That kind of works. Definitely improvement over the previous engine. So, you know, yeah, it's pretty, yeah. I would say it's not a bad sort of engine. Obviously, when going up hills, you really will struggle, but you're not going to crawl around the place. And depending on the environments you're at, if you go down a hill or go up through things, you've actually got a fair amount of decent maneuverability. Your traverse speed as well is actually pretty damn good, being at 28, which is not bad at all, to be honest with you. Certainly nothing to be displeased at. And it's, you know, it's not over 30, admittedly, but that said, it's, you know, you are capable of reacting to something fairly quickly. You're not a medium or a light tank by any means, but you can at least have an ability to, for example, react to heavy tanks pushing through one flank and then be like, right, oh crap, we've got a medium tank, let's try and crank the gun round, which actually does help when it comes to shooting enemy targets on the move on that frontier. Now, on to armor. The Tiger Tank doesn't really benefit from a lovely amount of armor, nor does it benefit from any real angling. Well, you have 100mm of armor to the front, the sides, and the rear. Same goes for the turret. But as you can see, it is flat. There are very few angled surfaces on this machine, and if there was, they're very poorly done. So this thing is pretty much the representation of, well, with the exception of the SU-100Y, box tank. There is, you know, if we're going to use a little bit of a different mod, which allows me to do this free cam in the garage, handy, you can see it is completely boxy from there to there, there to there. So it is very, very box-like, and as such, the hopes of you being able to, you know, try and angle is not very good. I mean, you can side scrape, definitely a possibility to side scrape, and I did learn elements of angling when it came to doing stuff, but unfortunately, if you're out in the complete open, you really cannot rely on your tank to angle to save itself, because unlike tanks, for example, like, let's go with the Tiger II or the E-75. You can at least, with angling, for example, if you do it like that, there's a chance that a lot of the enemies might shoot there and it'll bounce off, or you might get lucky and it'll bounce off there. Probably not. Tiger Tank is the same deal. You know, King Tiger, you can angle to try and do something, whereas with this, it's pen. There are very few ways you can angle to defend yourself with, so it is going to be a pain. And for anyone who's not that experienced with this particular tank, or those who don't really understand angling or side scraping very well, this will be a very frustrating tank for you, because it'll constantly take hits and you will not be able to do anything about it for a while. But that said, it does help train you to learn how to side scrape and angle, which is something valuable to be considered. Unfortunately, also, this vehicle has two extra problems you have to worry about. Underglacial transmission issues, where basically if the enemy shoots this part of your tank, your transmission gets buggered, which previously you also used to set your tanks on fire, but then Wargaming nerfed that. So that's a problem as well. And unfortunately, ammo racking. Though I have not been ammo racked much in this tank, I have been close. When I say ammo racked, I mean actual ammo racking detonation. I have been shot and I have lost lots of shells. So there, you know, you can have that issue as well. So definitely be careful in regards to that. This whole area that I'm mousing over right now is roughly the area that an ammo rack is located. So if you're ever engaging a Tiger, try and aim dead on center, underneath, preferably underneath this section here. There as well, but like around here is the best area to try and ammo rack him. Sorry, Tiger driver. Sorry, Tiger drivers, if you realised that was the only weakness, but still. Yeah, it's not a very easy tank to work with when it comes to armour. So, obviously, you don't want to go into a brawl with this thing, and you can also see why having 1,500 hit points helps, so that if you make a bit of a mistake, you can potentially recover from it, but still, you're not really going to hold up much of a prayer. Going over to the Sphere range and Signa range, however, we do start to see where the tactics of this tank start to come into fold. We're going to use this, the items. First of all, the view range, you have 380 view range. That is incredibly good for a heavy tank. That's almost tier 9 levels. You know, that's like, tier 8 levels. You know, tier 8 tanks enjoy this level of view range almost. I think they probably enjoy slightly more, but you're pretty much close to it. You're doing very good, considering that other vehicles probably have 360. Let's have a look. Let's actually get a direct comparison. What about you? Yeah, so you're like 10 meters behind the Koenigsteiger's view range. So that's something to be happy about, and does start to promote the image of a sniper material, long range engagements, something which might be considered a viable tactic to be utilized along with this vehicle. And going on to the signal range, my absolute favorite upgrade of all time, the Fug 12. Oh yes, the Fug 12. I love this radio. I don't know why, but every time I see the Fug 12, I just smile. And this particular upgrade I've had for years has gotten me through. Like, I got this particular upgrade back when I got the Panzer III. Was it a Panzer III? Fairly convinced it was a Panzer III, or it was a Panzer III IV. But either way, when I got this upgrade, it was a Panzer III. So yeah, when I got this thing on the Panzer III, I never had to worry about radios for a long time. I mention this a lot when it comes to the German vehicles, and probably in my future reviews where this is involved, I'll say it again. But I cannot stop loving this upgrade. So, yes. Definitely a good thing, because it means you never have to worry about looking at the minimap and not being able to see your targets ever again. You know, it's a great upgrade. So definitely, once again, improves the you can shoot from a long range and do well with it concept. Now, onto my favorite part of any review, the gun. And the L71 is probably the best 88mm cannon you can grab these days, at least at this tierage. Here she is. As you can see, she is available on a variety of different tanks. Tag the Indian Panzer, Tiger P, VK Ausführung B, Panther 2, Ausführung A, E50, E75. This gun is definitely a great gun, and at this tier, it's just beautiful. She has an 8.96 rate of fire, 203mm worth of pen on standard, 237 on premium, 44 on high explosive, 240 alpha on standard and premium, 295 on high explosive, accuracy 0.34 with a 2.7 second aiming time. This gun is great, you know, this is basically what makes this tank the sniper tank. The poor armor doesn't help, but its view range and signal range allows it to really crunk into position and stationary points and fire some good shots against the enemy. Obviously, this doesn't mean that you should camp at the back of the field, but what this means is that instead of having to be the tank to push in and because your gun either won't hit the target or you can't see because you're blind, you can actually be kind of a nice second-line tank, which allows you to utilize your teammates to push through or be able to, if you have to hold a position, not in your base, by the way, you can actually hold the position relatively well with a good rate of fire. If we look at the specifics, my reload with 3 equipment modules is 5.7 seconds, so it's a 10.6 rate of fire for me. This is great because 203mm of pen, at least tier 7 and 8 games, you're fine. Tier 9 games, you may start to have issues when it comes to certain heavy armored vehicles, but at the same time, still 203mm worth of pen is more than adequate to deal with it. Tier 10, different story. But luckily, at Tier 7, you're never going to have to worry. But still, brilliant in Tier 7. And don't forget, you get to face Tier 5s with this thing. So, you may get elements of games where you can become the Tiger everyone feared. I can't tell you how amazing it is to be in a Tiger when you see two M4 Shermans look at you, panic and reverse because they see that you've got the L-71. Oh, das Krieg und Vaterland. Oh, I love this tank. This is the thing. You can snap shots into people, and it is just beautiful in how you do it. And I can never stop singing this gun, or this tank's praises enough, for that matter. The flaws with this tank definitely mean that you can't charge in and go crazy, but definitely this L-71 will serve you well if you have the patience to understand how it works. Now that we've talked enough about the stats of this particular vehicle, what we're going to do now is we're going to jump onto tanks.gg to compare this tank with your Tier 7 counterpart, so I will see you there. .gg with the Tiger tank and seven other vehicles to compare it against. The Tiger P, your Porsche counterpart, your T29, the IS, which is also going to be representing the IS-2 from China, as both tanks share pretty much the same stats, the AMX M445, the Black Prince, the Oni, and the KV-3. Now, a slightly side note as well is, as you can see, the names of all the vehicles ships to the right for some strange reason. I don't know why, but it does mean, of course, that we're going to get slight confusion as to some of the things. For example, you probably would be confused to see the Black Prince having 1,200 horsepower, but still only going 25. Like, 600 more only gives it 5 kilometers more! You're like, you're not going to imagine the rage that people would have. But no, it's the Oni, not the Black Prince. So that would be such a rip-off if you could have that. Like 60,000 experience and 700,000 credits for a 5 kilometer per hour speed boost. Oh, that would be so stupid. Anyway, so yeah, we're basically going to do the same thing as I do in the garage. We're going to go with movement, armor, view range, and gun. So let's start off with movement. So for movement, top speed wise, the Tiger is king with other vehicles only being 5 kilometers per hour slower. So you definitely are king of the hill in that regard. The closest being the AMX M445, the T29, and Tiger P having the same levels. Going on to engine and horsepower per ton, you can see that the most is done by the Oni, but really the one we want to pay attention to most, because the Oni is stupidly heavy, is actually the AMX M445, which has 850 horsepower, giving it a beautiful 15.46 horsepower per ton. The only vehicle that actually gets to it, or gets even close, is the IS with a 15.3, and that has the same level of horsepower as the Tiger. So while the IS and the AMX M4 are slower in top speed, they do beat you in acceleration, which means they are more likely to be able to react to things much faster than a Tiger could, which again kind of illustrates the sniper perspective, not moving very much, kind of slow to react, and if, for example, playing Battlefield, you can perhaps sneak up on one and message him saying you're behind him before he even reacts. So going on to armor, we're going on with hull first. So for hull-wise, the strongest level of hull armor is done by your Tiger P Kameraden. This guy is doing the Porsche variant of the Tiger, which means slightly better angling at the frontal armor as well, as much as also you get, it's still flat, but it's a lot better angling. And of course, 200mm does mean that in a lot of engagements, you can rely on that frontal armor a lot more than previously thought, with the least amount of armor going to what else but the French AMX M445, with 90 at the front, 40 to the sides and rear. I could pen the side of an AMX M4 with my high explosive shells. That sounds awesome. Now, going on to turrets, however, the undisputed king of the world is the American T29 with 279mm on the front, 127 to the sides, and 102 to the rear. Its rear armor and its turret is better than your frontal hull armor. That's how good the American turrets are. Even the Black Prince has a better rear turret armor than your frontal hull armor. Obviously, the Black Prince and the Oni are famous for having ridiculously well-angled turrets, as they are pretty much the best for holding stuff down. So definitely, definitely in the disadvantaged area there. Going on to hit points as well, whilst we're down here, the Tiger tank actually is beaten only by the Oni being at 1,550 hit points. Every other vehicle is at least 100 hit points, is only at least 50 hit points behind you, with the KV-3 being 1,400. I think the hit points of the Tiger P, or I don't know, I keep getting that feeling that the Tiger P is the original hit points of the Tiger, which does make sense, but then I see that and I'm thinking, wait, that could be the Tiger's P, that could be the original hit points of the Tiger. But either way, the 1,500 hit points that you get definitely proves an advantage against a majority of these other vehicles. Now, onto view range, let's have a look. So for view range, you can see we're pretty much across the board, with the exception of the IS, the AMX M445, the Black Prince. Oni is the same, with the KV-3 being at 340. So these three vehicles, we're pretty much equal on. So there's no distinct major advantage, but it is still a pretty damn good amount of view range for a heavy tank, considering that maybe just one tier below you, they're struggling to see 330. So a 50-meter increase is definitely an advantage. And again, it will strengthen your ability to understand sniping. Maybe a good idea. Even better with the Tiger P, because that means not only can you take a shot from the front, you can actually snipe them back. Huzzah. Finally, we will go to the gun and weapon handling. Probably we'll go with mainly penetration, damage, and reloads with accuracy and aiming time. So for the penetration, obviously, 203mm, the only vehicle that beats you is the AMX M445 with its gun doing the same level of damage, but with 9 extra pen on its side. So there is, you know, a better gun than the L71 for penetration on the standard shell, but still, it is incredibly good. The L71 is still incredibly good. And the only thing that really does any more damage than you is, of course, the IS tank with its 390 alpha gun. Same goes for the KV-3. The Black Prince is the one that suffers at the moment, because 150 is its best chance, only having a 17-pounder. Now, this is where the Tiger tank really starts to come into its own, because with the exception of the Black Prince, the rate of fire that the Tiger tank has is way faster than a majority of its counterparts. Even its Tiger 2, sorry, even the Tiger P struggles like by nearly 2 seconds in comparison to the Tiger. As said, the only vehicle that really that is better than the Tiger, and it's better by, you know, just over 2 seconds, is the Black Prince. So these two tanks are bloody good at sniping and shooting, you know, rapidly firing into the enemy, which definitely means that you can maximize any good DPM against your opponents. Obviously, it's, you know, as you can see, this is the only tank which has over 2k of DPM. That's pretty damn good. Like, normally I don't really care for these particular stats, because to me, I mean, I'm not a major pro into this game that I think, oh my god, DPM is the most highest important thing in my life. It's like, that's great and all, but there's no guarantee that the RNG is going to let me hit pen and do full damage every time I shoot. So, knowing that is great, but still, it's all dependent on the game. So, but still, that is a pretty nice thing to know. Going on to accuracy and aiming time, you can see the Tiger is beaten by the Black Prince and the T29 for a 2.21 aiming time. And for accuracy, the Tiger is actually pretty much on top. So, really, the Tiger tank, while it's not superior in the sense of armor or speed, it is superior in the sense of weapon handling, and it's in the superior in the sense of rapid fire. Now, this doesn't mean that the Tiger tank is the best out of all of them by far, but it does mean at least you can quite happily engage, for example, the IS. If the IS pops a shot over at you and misses, you can have the ability, whilst he's frenetically trying to reload, just plop shot after shot after shot until he's nearly dead, and then either you get to pop the kill or someone from the rear gets a shot off and knocks him out as well. then again, this, you know, this adds to the element of you're a decent support role, or if you aren't top tier and you do need to go into the thick of it, you can rest assured that this gun will not fail you, and in fact will do a crap ton of damage to help you out as well. So, with all that said, let's return to the garage. So guys, we've gone through enough of the theory, let's jump into the actual games themselves to show you what this particular tank is capable of in-game. So here we are on the first match in Corellia. I am in my Tiger tank, and we're on an assault mode actually. This I haven't really played in years, and when I reinstalled my World of Tanks client on my Windows 10 computer, I didn't actually... I forgot to set the assault modes to turn off, so I thought, okay, well, you know, let's give it a go. Obviously, we're going to have bad games, but, you know, let's give it a try at least. So, the game starts off, I spawn in the number one spawn area, or the two spawn area, I'm not entirely sure. Haven't done assaults in years. And as you can see, the maneuverability and the power-to-weight ratio of this thing, while it's not bad, it is kind of struggling to get up this hill, so... If you are in a position like this, maybe foresight and planning might be a good idea. I do kind of make a bit of a tunnel vision on this guy as I had a glimmer of a shot at him, trying to see if I can spot the tank. No, not quite. Oh, hello, I can see him again. That mod is actually quite handy as well. It does give me a little bit of an extra breathing room. I completely fluffed that previous shot, which is pretty bad sound. Good. And he takes a lot to fire. I fire again. I overestimate the speed of the tank, and by this point he is pretty much dead, so I'm like, right, okay, just wasted a couple of seconds, but oh dear. And as you can see, there isn't really that many vehicles on the push. Even though we're attacking the enemy base, we're not as aggressive in our attack. We've lots of TDs camping in the middle with a few heavy tanks as well as some light tanks covering the side. And the Black Prince, while he is making a push towards the middle, he does decide to park himself behind that rock. So really, at this point in the game, I am the most aggressive in the team. Though luckily for me, I wasn't having to engage all those heavy tanks up in the north. However, we do still have a fair amount of bad guys to push who are defending against them. I spot an enemy KV-2 camping in the background there. Hopefully my guys will be able to spot him. And a T-50 which tries to pop a shot against us, but doesn't. And this is the thing, when you get the tank, this is the brilliant thing. You fire one shot, AMX-12T tries to shoot me, nice rate of fire, 5.56 reload, bang, that's a tank that really should have moved after the first shot, but didn't quite work out. I try and hump the rock to no avail. I aggressively move up first. Fortunately, T-150 does get a good shot into me, not the greatest, but then... of keep an eye out for where the enemy tank is. Battle is going crazily up in the north. I would want to withdraw, but I'm telling the guys in the medium, in the mid, and oh boy, that was an ISU. And artillery tries to have a go at it as me as well, so not only do I dodge artillery, I dodge an ISU. And this is the thing about the rate of fire of this tank. He fires one shot, I track him, and now if I had any other vehicle, he would have gotten away with it. But because I was able to get a tracking shot, he was able to get tracks fixed only just a little bit too late when he was spotted long enough for our team to move in and knock him out. And so now the game is getting quite dangerous as the T-150 is getting sort of aggressive. I fire, good shot into his side, keeping an eye on him, being a little bit crazy, trying to use the rock as sort of a way to side scrape. He fluffs his shot against me next. I fire into the black, hopefully trying to sort of side scrape around it. Messaging to my team, yo guys, watch out, there is a bad guy there, be careful. T-150 constantly trying to make sure he's not going to do anything. Get a nice shot into the T-150, who then dies and burns to death. And then the enemy KV-2 appears. I get a horrible low roll, and I'm now terrified of getting shot. Bam, he does hit me and knock my gunner out, but luckily, because I've not taken too much damage, I can tank the shot, so that is at least something. Anyway, the game now is pretty much working to our favor, though the enemy team in the north has taken out all of our guys to the north, so I'm trying to mention to our 12T to cap, and unfortunately because of the replay glitch, every message that you send inside the The game, for some reason, is doubled, which one of which is a censored and one of which is a non-censored. So anyway, the enemy team starts to make a major push for the enemy, and I'm trying to gun across the hill. I am getting close to my top speed of 40 kilometers per hour when all of a sudden I spot an enemy KV-4, and I kind of have a slight panicky moment because I'm like, oh boy, as that thing doesn't take too much to kill you. But for some reason, I couldn't quite get the shot on. He was behind a rock at the time, so I make a way to push forward. Enemy tank spotted to my right. The game is pretty much on our favor now, and I spot the KV-4. And I load premium because I'm fairly aware of the shots. And I make a bit of a mistake here. I clutch shot this KV-4 here. He gets a shot in, but it doesn't do much damage. And I had a beautiful side shot, but instead my brain went to automatically going for the Underglacius. So if there is one thing I will say that you want to not do is go for the Underglacius. If I had gone for a side shot, I probably could have done some damage to him and earned myself a little bit more than 1430. But that said, not a bad game at all. And I will now go to the results of that game. We had a lovely little victory. Nothing immensely special. We did get the spotter token, as well as get a mastery badge second class, earning 42,000 credits and 1,361 experience. Going to the team score, we earned the second most experience out of the whole game, and was only slightly behind on that on the AMX-12T, who did a damn good job for his thing, so well played to him on that one. Well, also commiserations for our enemy team, especially the KV-4, who had a pretty damn good game. He had nearly 3k damage, and unfortunately was just taken down by just unfortunately not getting having a very good team. Unfortunately, the damage in his team is very like a whole bunch of tanks didn't do that, so my apologies and commiserations to him, but unfortunately the game had to be won by one team. Anyway, guys, I'll see you next in the other game. And here we are once again for another game in the Tiger. This time we're on sandy rivers, and again we're doing another assault mode, though at the time I kind of made the mistake of thinking we were on the attacking team. This just goes to show how long I've not played assault zones. But we're in the Tiger tank, we're top tier, and we are going to be facing off against a pretty good variety of enemy opponents whilst we're making our way towards the objective. Now, I'm just going to speed things up here, because not really much happens for a time. T-37 makes a push against our team. I try and make a maneuver around with for fear of getting shot at by artillery slash enemy TDs, when a Challenger tank sends a message out to the team saying, help, I'm on his side. So I realize I got to go there. So I'm like, you know what, let's be the good gentleman here. Let's try and send him in to help with the backup. So I make my initial push towards helping him out, which by then the Cromwell tank has already arrived, and I kind of feel like I've wasted my bloody time, which is not great. So not an exactly a majorly eventful game in the first half, but then we finally get into position to start engaging the T-37, who is being very aggressive, trying to take on an Oni with just a tier 6 tank. I mean, I'm sorry, but that's not entirely the most intelligent of decisions, Mr. T-37. And the T-37 promptly regrets his decision, because I get a nice, extremely good high roll into that tank, leaving him on pitifully low health. And then an SU-100 appears to challenge my right to live. So now we must engage this feral person. So I decide to break through the tank's position, and just as I go through, bam, fire. I take a shot from his 122, but with 1,500 hit points, I can tank it. I try and aim for his lower half of the SU-100 to try and see if I can knock out his ammo rack. And I wait until I'm reloaded, fast rate of fire, bam! And there goes the SU-100. Unfortunately, couldn't ammo rack him at that point. Now, at first, I wanted to try and see if I could push up towards where the Stug and the other tanks were located, but then I realized this tank would take forever trying to cross. So instead, let's try and see if we can outflank the M6 and the KV-1, whilst also trying to figure out where the hell the flak bus was. And trying to figure it out when, oh, there's the flak bus. Hello. Nice instant shooting there. Try and relocate to another position. He fires. I think he's got the stock gun. Next shot, unfortunately, misses, but this is a little bit pitiful. It's like the flak bus is like, meow, as he tries to escape. But unfortunately, I put him out of his misery and take him out. Cromwell gets a cheeky shot into my side, doing a little bit of damage, but nothing especially worrying. And I try and take a shot at this guy. I fire, he gets a shot into me, only doing 91 high explosive, a little bit frustrating. And then we kind of start a bit of an engagement with the enemy M6. I kind of want to move into position before I take a charge. KV-1 moving into position. I'm aware of the Cromwell. Don't want to sacrifice too much of my hit points in case the artillery fires and hits me, because the artillery was popping tanks. And there's the tank that I was most worried about, the enemy M12. And the T-37, who was being super aggressive and sacrificed himself, decides to be the ultimate douchebag and tries to report his teammates. And I get a nice side-on moving shot against the Cromwell tank. I get a nice shot, another shot into the M12. Sorry, first shot into the M12. Just about ready, and bam, there's an artillery kill and a Cromwell tank. I actually take the time to send a message out to report our guys, report the T-37 to our guys. And whilst that's going on, I could have got a shot in on the Cromwell, but luckily nothing too serious, as the Cromwell was taken out by my good friends. And another sort of relatively nothing really happening game. Maybe I should have sent a message after the Cromwell had died. But again, nothing especially big about this game, but still damn good. It shows at least the concept that tank can fire fast. Maneuverability isn't great, but it can withstand a few shells on the side. I mean, I'm surprised I was actually... This, the main reason why I wanted to show you this particular game was that I bounced something on my side. I think there's the bounce mark. Flat armor bounces a Cromwell. I am kind of impressed. In fact, I think I took it on the side as well. So how that happened, I don't know. But either way, I thought this game needs to be shown because I bounced something in the cave in the Tiger 1 on a flat side, doing absolutely nothing to prevent it from getting penned. Anyway, guys, I'll see you at the results of this game. So, here are the results of that game. Another solid victory, earning us 36,000 credits, 1,176 experience, a fire for effect, and once again, a Mark II second class mastery. Going to the team scores, we can see that although we got second place again, it was still a reliable result. The Cromwell just going ridiculously ham in that game, earning himself 3k, so well done to him. Commiserations to our opponents, though not the T-37, because he won the douchebag of the match award for trying to reveal his teammates. But commiserations to the SU-100, who was actually having a pretty damn good game. And unfortunately, my rapid-firing 88mm stopped him. So, unfortunately, not the greatest for that one for his team, but that said, another solid good result. Anyway, guys, I will take you now to the third and final game. And we're back for the third and final game of the video. We are on the Himmelsdorf map, standard engagement, and I am in my Tiger. This time, the matchmaking not so favorable. We are facing tier 5s, the most terrifying of all. No, we're facing tier 8s. And myself and a Panther 2 are nearly the only guys coming through. The Stuart Emil is following us in the background. And this particular map, I wanted to show you the characteristics of its turret, because it can have the capacity, despite having only 100mm of armor, it can have the capacity to do a lot of good when held down. So we maneuver into position, relocate so that way I'm not such an oblivious target, and then an SU-152 appears, and I get a nice shot into him. 3 seconds to reload. Take my time aiming, fire another shot. That one unfortunately doesn't connect as much as it should have done. Unfortunately went into the ground. Take my time, fire another cheeky shot there. Would have killed him, in fact, if I had the same level of high rolls. And then we get this IS-3, hit him in the side, Panther tracks him, and then we proceed to do what is probably the most frustrating thing for any heavy tank in the early stages of a game, getting constantly tracked. Enemy SU-152 tries shooting at us, but unfortunately to no avail. And so now I prioritize shooting at the tracks to keep him perma-tracked, and then I get the chance to hitting the main wheel, which will go through and do some damage. IS-3 cottons onto it. 88 is making a shot, but I'm now fighting on 88, getting a good few shots in. I'm trying to avoid getting shot, but at the same time, I'm going to try and tank it. 88 getting more consistent shots there. Frustrating, admittedly. IS-3 bounced, and another shot went in, and just as the IS-3 gets finished with his tracks again, he survives, and the Sturmmil finishes him off. I try and see if I can get a shot in. at the 88 to no luck. 88 pops his shot again. Try and see if I can get a shot in. Fire. Shell bounces off the main armor. So unfortunately, not able to knock him out, but see if we can try and get some shots in. Take my time aiming, trying to find a decent weak point, because unfortunately the 88 does have the ability of a good shot. Then I get a cheeky shot into the T26E4, and we'll just pause the video for a sec just to highlight. So unfortunately you can see a lot of the shells from the 88 did hit and pen me, but then if you see where the other tank was, the, let's see, have a look, see, has the thing deleted itself? No, I think we have a, yeah, there it is, somewhere around there. We've got, there it is, right. It's kind of blended just with that, but you can see the gun mantle, it didn't really do much to protect me on that one, but there was an occasion where one of the IS-3 shells pinged off the side. So while this thing isn't perfect for sights, like for turret against, for example, say an 88, it was able to bounce an IS-3 shell with a top gun. So not bad. Not bad at all. Anyway, I'm just checking to see which parts of the turret he hit me from. And I realize, ooh, we have the opportunity to do some good here. The game is looking pretty good. We've taken out two of the enemy tanks. Let's see what we can do. Now, I'm a little hesitant at this point. Probably should have gone a little bit earlier. Panther tank had gone earlier, so now we start to make our push. And trying to see if we can get a side shot of the OI, to no luck. See if we can get a shot in on the T-71, no luck on any of those targets. So now we start to move. Then I spot the enemy M44, try and see if we can get it, but the M44 gets taken out. Enemy VK-1000-1P comes in, and I get a good quick snapshot into the position. KV-85 spots me, he misses his chance. I take another shot from the VK-3001P. And this, I will not deny, is a bit of a mistake on my part. I kind of panic run, and I try and get into cover here, not really being paying attention to the T-2064, which decides to shoot high explosive into me. And another bit of hesitation there, whilst the VK is still looking in my direction. T-2064 throws another shell in my direction. Somehow the shell goes straight through his turret without doing anything. High explosive again by the enemy T-2064. I now say sod it, desperately try and go out. VK's taken down. And around enemy T-2064. I get some shots in. Reinforcements. Enemy T-71 tries to get around to flank. I pop him, knocking him out. And try and have another go. Bang, good shot. Luckily, I was able to get a shot in, and the T-26E4 goes out. Take my time. Artillery trying to have a go at the T-26E4 for me, but unfortunately doesn't do anything. I fire again. This time my shell doesn't do anything, but his shell does pen. And at this point, the game is suddenly makes a turn for the worse. I spot the ISU-152. He has the gun. Bang, target destroyed. I bounce the T-26E4's gun. And now it's just a matter of, well, shit. Hopefully reinforcements can come around. But unfortunately, I get a shot in, and sadly, I die to the T-26E4, so not the greatest. And the Panther comes just a little bit too late with the 75mm L-70, and our team somehow completely collapses in the north. Like, I don't know. Nah. Artillery finally takes out the T-26, but at this point, this game is pretty much lost. I mean, the tanks try and assemble some form of resistance against him, but it's not really looking good. Artillery not really in the best of positions. OI completely sucking. And a game which at first was looking absolutely fantastic suddenly decides nope, and decides to give the enemy the victory. So unfortunately, we weren't able to do it. But we'll play to our opponents on that one. We'll just skip forward now to the game. Panther tank decides to get locked down by an AT-15. Not a very good choice. Stuart Emil does a damn good job trying to knock out the T-32. Unfortunately, to no avail. AT-15A pins down the Panther 2. He dies, unfortunately. Stuart Emil tries to get the kill on him. Low rolls the T-32, which is a real shame because that should have killed the T-32, but the T-32 just got RNG blessed. And then, of course, the one thing that I cannot abide, the scumbag did a scumbag. So, unfortunately, not willing to give his precious hit points to the enemy, he decides to commit suicide, earning him the title of absolute bastard. So, yeah, report the scumbag on that one. Because that was a douchey move on his part. And unfortunately, a game which was looking really nice just suddenly died around us. And of course, that's the one where I do the most damage, getting a high caliber. I'll take you the results of that game. So having two solid victories with nothing special in between them, of course, the best results is when we lose. Yes, well done, Wargaming. Or no, sorry, well done, World of Tanks, I should say. Yes, so for a mastery badge, ace tanker, a high caliber, and a fire for effect, we of course lose, earning 51,000 credits, 999, and we earn 1,805 experience in total. Going to the team scores, I earned the most experience in my team, plus doing the most damage in my team. Of course. Yes, so rather frustrating. Well played to our opponents, though. They definitely seemed to be... They were obviously the ones who were the better players. It's a bit of a shame that it all happened at the last moment, but there you go. Unfortunately, cannot do a thing about it. But still, nonetheless frustrating. But still, nothing we... You know, I played to the best of the time. If I had to look back, I would definitely say going to the left rather than... I should have taken the railroad rather than go to the left, because that completely left me open. So if I could do that match again, I would have, after taking out the IS-3, probably would have shifted to the right a lot sooner and engaged the enemy forces before, you know, moving around to them, potentially getting a chance to knock out the enemy T-26 Pershing. But unfortunately, I didn't do that because I panicked a bit and hesitated. And when you're playing the game, your brain goes through a different process than you do when you're looking at it from the backside, so... Anyway, guys, I will now take you to the garage for the end of the review. So, guys, there you have it. The Panzerkampfwagen Ausführung 6 Tiger Tank. This thing is definitely worth the grind. I think if you're a fan of a tank which has great rate of fire, great gun handling, and while doesn't have the greatest of armor, and maybe... not the greatest of maneuverability, this thing does still provide a useful tank, as it can get to an objective, hold a position if necessary, and provide supportive fire as your teammate to either push into the objective, or you try and hold off the enemy forces as they try and push onto your objective. It does take a little bit of getting used to try and learn how to work with the armor, since it is so incredibly flat. But it also works well to teach you how to side-scrape if you're still not 100% familiar with the concept of side-scraping if you reach Tier 7. Anyway, guys, that's it for this review. Thank you very much for watching this. If you like this kind of content, don't forget to hit the like button down below. Hit the subscribe button if you want to see more content. And, of course, put in the comment section what you think about this tank and, you know, what kind of things you like or dislike about it. Maybe you agree with my review, or you think that this tank is the worst German heavy tank in the game, and that clearly the Tiger P is superior because it's got 200 frontal armor, and it's got the same gun, and it's got the Porsche engines, which makes it faster, or it could be something completely different. Feel free to put in the comment section down below. Anyway, I'll catch you next time. This is Miss Jaeger, signing out.